welcome to the Spreadsheet News Network. I'm Matt Parker, and our top story today is that the UK government has bungled its positive COVID case database because of some spreadsheet abuse. We have covered very similar spreadsheet mistakes before, so we thought this breaking news would be a perfect opportunity for our long-running segment, Some Updates. Some update. The UK government temporarily lost 15,841 positive COVID test results from their database between the 25th of September and the 2nd of October. And when the news broke on Monday this week, everyone was sending it to me, and I was very interested because in a previous video, less than a year ago, called When Spreadsheets Attack, I talked about how an anonymous source had told me about a government program, an infrastructure situation somewhere in the world where they had issues because there were only a finite number of rows in Excel and they were using that as a database. I wasn't allowed to talk about the exact details, but now it's happened again. Spreadsheets do not go on forever. If you open a modern version of Excel and push some variation on Command and down, you will skip to the very last row, which is row number 1,048,576. That's where the spreadsheet stops. And that number is 2 to the power of 20, because of course it's stored in binary somewhere in the system. But I thought, well, hang on, that can't be the issue, because that's a big number. That's way more than the daily number of positive COVID cases in England. And then the rumors started to circulate that whoever was storing this data in an Excel spreadsheet was using the columns for the data points instead of the rows, which is unbelievable. That goes against the very fundamentals of nature to use columns for data points, but that could explain the problem because they are also finite. If you push Command right arrow, you will skip to the last column, which is XFD. That corresponds to the number 16,384, or 2 to the power of 14. And that's where the columns stop. So that was a lot more plausible. However, everyone here at the Spreadsheet News Network have been unable to verify that rumor. It is unsubstantiated that they were using columns. However, it is suspiciously specific for that to have come out. But we just don't know. The official BBC reporting says that they were using rows, except they were using an older version of Excel.
The BBC reports that Public Health England was receiving test data from various testing sites as comma-separated value, CSV, files, and it then used an automatic process to combine those CSVs into a new Excel file template, which it then uploaded to a central government system.
So instead of the modern version of Excel, which came out in Office 2007, and you've got the .xlsx file format, which goes down to over 1 million rows, they were using the older pre-2007 version .xls, which stops after 36,536 rows. However, if they were losing positive COVID cases because the spreadsheet was always stopping at the same point, why on earth did no one notice? To find out more, we're going to our reporter on the street, Matt Parker. Thank you, Matt. Yes, the obsolete .xls format does cap out at 65,536 rows. It would have been very suspicious if the same number of cases were being reported day after day. But one of the reasons why I originally thought this wasn't an Excel finite number of rows problem is because the number of cases per day is well below 65,000. It turns out each positive case had a number of rows associated with it, and according to official reporting, it was capping out at roughly 1,400 positive cases, which means we can estimate they had about 47 rows each. But because it varied, a slightly different number was reported every day, which is why it took so long to detect this problem. Do we have any idea why they were using the old format from the 1980s rather than the new format, which has been in widespread use for over a decade now? That is a very good point, Matt. Now, the fact that they refer to automating the process of importing the CSV files leads me to believe they might have been using a macro, some kind of VBA setup, and you can't run macros in a .xlsx file, whereas you can in the older .xls obsolete format. So potentially they were doing that, although you can run macros in the newer .xlsm format. So that may not be the case. There could be a different programming language or some kind of setup that had to use the older file format. Whatever's happening, we can reasonably believe that this could happen because we have actually been contacted by an anonymous source within the NHS, the National Health Service. And this is totally true, by the way. They got in touch and said that even up until very recently, we believe this year, they were using an old database within the NHS, which had been around for over a decade. And if they wanted to export a selection of those data points, because of a compatibility issue, they could only export it as a .xls format, and so they had to make sure their search was returning fewer than 65,536 results. And so according to our anonymous source, this is something that does happen within the NHS, so it is believable that it happened within National Health England. Thank you very much, Matt. So while we don't know the exact details of what happened, it is seemingly agreed upon that the UK government was using an Excel spreadsheet, or at least the Excel file format, to store important medical data. Why on earth were they using a spreadsheet? And just so I'm not too hypocritical here, I will admit that I am publicly, even famously, a big fan of spreadsheets. And I definitely use them in situations where I wouldn't. I made a video a while ago about complex Fibonacci numbers, and in that video, I used a spreadsheet to do the plotting, which was, you know, objectively the wrong way to do that. That video was being discussed on Twitter the day before this news broke about the UK government spreadsheet abuse on Monday, and in that discussion on Twitter, people were saying, while it's a great video, it's a bit weird that I used a spreadsheet to plot the numbers when I had so carefully calculated them using Python. And I totally agree, if you do your calculations in Python, there are way better ways to plot the results. But I wasn't fluent in those other methods, and I already knew how to use a spreadsheet. And as I said on Sunday, which is now not aged well, I said that sometimes, instead of finding and learning how to use a chisel, you turn to the hammer you're already holding. And I stand by that. I love spreadsheets because anyone can give them a go. You can mess around with some numbers. You can do some recreational mathematics. You can do your own data analysis on a small, safe scale. But at some point, it's no longer appropriate to just use a spreadsheet. You should use something a lot more robust. But where is that line? To find out, we sent our reporter on the street, Matt Parker, to ask an expert. Matt? Yes, I was able to speak to someone at the European Spreadsheet Risk Interest Group, or USPRIG, real organization. I love them, and they provided a comment in the form of an Excel formula. I mean, we asked if they could, but they were totally on board. And this formula indicates that if what you're doing is some kind of critical situation, then you should use a formal software engineering process. You should do this properly. If it's not critical, but it's just important, then you should probably still use a real database. And if it's not critical or important, then you know what? Have some fun with spreadsheets. So there you are. That equation formula comment came to us from the chair of programming at USPRIG, Dr. Simon Thorne. So there you are. Spreadsheets, use them responsibly. I'm not saying don't use them. Spreadsheets give anyone access to basic data analysis and doing all sorts of great calculations. And I even accept businesses are gonna use Excel spreadsheets. It's called Microsoft Office, after all. It's gonna be used in offices. But businesses should understand, if they're using Excel files, which is fine, that there are some risks and there are some limitations, and they need to know what they are. And for the case of the UK government storing life or death medical data in an Excel file format, I mean, I said it on Monday when the news broke, and I'll say it again now. I still stand by it. That is breathtaking incompetence. You cannot just throw together some scripts that use Excel files when you've got national significant medical data. We should expect far more from the UK government during a time of national crisis and a pandemic. I have no idea how National Health England can justify data in a spreadsheet. Well, I guess they would say they can justify data being in a spreadsheet because it's a lot easier that way. In fact, there's a button to justify it, and you can't do that in a CSV now, can you? And I would say, well played. Up next, there's finally a cure for spreadsheets autocorrect mutating genes. See you in a moment.
Do you suffer from having to organize and analyze a small set of numbers? Is the undo function on a calculator frustratingly underpowered for your calculations needs? Do you want to dabble in recreational mathematics? Then spreadsheets may be for you.
I'd scraped mortgage rates from several lenders and needed to make some basic forecasts on what the cost would be over the length of the loans. I decided spreadsheets was perfect for me because partly I had only a small set of data and I could easily track and verify the calculations myself. But more importantly, I wasn't running a life-critical government health database in a time of national crisis.
Please speak to your database developer before deciding if spreadsheets is right for you. Common side effects include accidentally sorting some but not all of the data, slight cell loss when selecting numbers, hashtag name question mark, losing key medical data during a pandemic and endangering lives, and being fired. Spreadsheets is intended for short-term use only. Stop using spreadsheets if you find yourself in charge of a government database with life and death ramifications. Spreadsheets, from the makers of WordArt.
Welcome back. Some update. We have previously covered how Microsoft Excel will auto-correct the names of human genes like March 5 or Sep 15, their real gene names, into dates, completely removing the original data. And this is a widespread problem. As we covered previously, in 2016, researchers in Melbourne found 3,597 bits of original genetic research spanning a decade, and of those, 19.6% of them had errors introduced because of Excel autocorrect. The problem has now finally been solved. With more details on this, we go once again to our reporter on the street, Matt Parker. Thank you, Matt Parker. Yes, they were able to fix the problem by renaming the genes. They in no way updated Excel or changed spreadsheets or even changed how people were doing their research. Rather, the Human Genome Organization in their Gene Nomenclature Committee renamed 27 genes so their names would no longer be auto-corrected in Excel. So for example, things like SEPT1 became SEPTIN1. It was easier to just rename human genes. Easy fix. Back to you, Matt Parker. Thank you very much, Matt Parker. Hang on, Matt Parker, are you saying that if names start to get confusing, you can just change them? Yes, Matt Parker, that is absolutely correct. If names are confusing, you can just change them. Maybe use something different to avoid all the issues. But I, Matt Parker, don't like the sound of that. Back to you, Matt Parker. Thanks, Matt Parker. Nor do I. Well, that concludes this installment of Some Updates. Thank you so much, everyone who sent in the spreadsheet stories as they were breaking. I'm sure there are plenty more to come. But for now, we go to Matt Parker with the sport. Thanks, Matt. We start sport with the VBA playoffs, and things are getting very interesting in the virtual machine bubble as the Pseudocodes maintain a lead over the Miami Max. Hey everyone, I hope you enjoyed the Spreadsheet News Network. Thank you so much to all my Patreon supporters who mean I can make such a ridiculous video. But it was a lot of fun, and I do think it's actually quite an important issue. A huge thanks to my friend Gemma Arrowsmith, who did the spreadsheet commercial for me in the middle of the video. She is absolutely amazing. You can check out her YouTube channel, but she never really uploads. She does, however, run courses for people who want to get into writing or performing comedy in terms of like sitcoms and sketches and all sorts of great stuff. I will link to all her stuff below. Definitely worth checking out. And finally, I wasn't sure where else to put this because a while ago, at the beginning of the lockdown, I made a video on my second channel that some of you may have seen where I was pointing out that late night talk show hosts in the US were terrible at filming at home. It was kind of like a fun video, and I wanted to get across some filming tips for people who were suddenly either teaching or hosting TV shows or doing stuff online that they weren't used to. However, Seth Myers got in touch and we had an ongoing chat where I was trying to help out with all the various bits of filming they were doing. Seth is now back in the studio, but on their very last episode filmed at home, they gave me a fantastic shout out. I wanted to pass that on to everyone here because they were basically saying how great the internet can be and I only get to do all these ridiculous things, be it a fake news network or helping my comedy idols film at home. It's all because a fantastic community of people watch these videos and support them. Thank you so much. This is all for you.